free. Jesus, I'll never forget how you brought me out. Jesus, I'll never forget. No, never. Jesus, I'll never forget what you've done for me. How you set forget how you brought me out. Jesus, I'll never forget, no, never. Jesus, I'll never forget what you've done for me. Jesus, I'll never forget how you set me free. Jesus, I'll never forget how you brought me out. Jesus, I'll never forget, no, never. Jesus, I'll never forget what you've done for me. Jesus, I'll never forget how you set me free. Jesus, I'll never forget how you brought me out. Jesus, I'll never forget, no, never. Hallelujah, Jesus. We will never forget, Jesus, what you've done for us. Lord, we lift you up. We praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You know, I was raised up that there's power in the blood, and I still believe it this day. How many believe there's power in the blood? Hallelujah. Worship with us.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood. There's power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood.
For power in the blood. Oh, there.
in the precious blood of the Lamb. Power, power, wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder working power in the precious blood.
Jesus, we give you all the praise. Hallelujah, Jesus. We worship you. I want to be holy like Jesus. Worship with us.
Lord, I want to be holy, set apart for you. Lord, I want to be holy, a vessel tried and true. When I come into your throne room, I receive the strength that I need to make my life a living sacrifice for you.
As a human being, I make mistakes every day. And I'm always asking the Lord to change me. Because that's really all we should be asking Him to do for us, is to change us. Worship with us.
Change me, Lord. Change me, Lord. Don't stay the same. I want to be more like you. Take my life, make my life just what you want it to be.
We thank you, Lord Jesus, for looking into our hearts, Lord, and searching us, Jesus, to change us for the good, God. We praise you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen. There's nothing like the presence of the Lord that can change us. Amen. Thank you, Brother Tate. God bless you. You may be seated. Sister Fern is coming, and she's going to lift up the Lord in song. Amen. I appreciate Sister Fern. She's been singing for a few years. And she's still giving the Lord praise, lifting up the name of the Lord. Amen. When we get to heaven, she's not going to have anybody help her up the steps. Neither am I or you. Amen. Sister Fern, we love you. You do a great job. God bless you. Worship with her. She sings.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Well, it's been a while since I've been up here. I always dreaded to go up the steps because when I fell and pulled my arm out of place, that's how I was doing. I was going down some steps. And I guess I just got a fear of going up and down steps. So I've asked my wonderful son-in-law to help me up so I won't fall. So I appreciate the Lord and all he's done. I thank him for everything he's done for me. It seems like this past year has been really a trying time for me, but I kept my faith in God, and he has helped me. So you see, I just got to keep going on, and I've got too much to gain to lose to stop now. Amen. Too many miles behind me, too many trials are through, and too many tears I need to remember. There's just too much to gain to lose. Too many sunsets rivers that my feet have walked through, and too many treasures waiting over yonder. There's just too much to gain to lose. I've crossed the hot, burning desert. I was struggling the right road to choose, but somewhere up ahead, I know there's cool, clear waters and defeated.
waters.
You see my feet have walked through and too many treasures waiting over yonder. There's just too much to gain, to lose. And too many sunsets that lie behind that mountain. There's too many rivers.
One day with the Lord, you've walked too long to turn around. There's too much to gain to lose. Amen. Thank you, Sister Fern, for that beautiful song. If you'd like to stand with me tonight, I'm going to read in John chapter 1, verse 1, and John chapter 1, verse number 14. John chapter 1. We're going to continue our series of lessons on the red words in Acts. And John chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So when the Word came forth, it was God speaking. Verse 14 says, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. That's referring to Jesus Christ. So whenever the words of Jesus are speaking, are recorded, that's God speaking to us, because Jesus is the Almighty God manifest in flesh, right?
Yes, sir.
So we find many times throughout the gospel accounts the words of Jesus recorded. And then we find them again recorded a few times in the book of Acts, and we find them again recorded in the book of Revelation as well. And so this series of lessons is probably going to be 3 weeks long, last week, this week, and one more. We're going to be exploring the red words, or the words of Jesus that are recorded in the book of Acts. And so there's some very interesting things for us to learn from these passages. So I pray the Lord will help us to learn them. Turn around to somebody, shake their hand, tell them you're glad they're here before you're seated. God bless you. My wife reminded me tonight not to take a long time in review. So I gave her a short synopsis of review and did it in probably about 3 or 4 minutes. And I said, is that swift enough? And she said, that would be perfect. So let's see if I can do it twice in a row. You notice in your Bible, as I mentioned to you last week, the red letters. This is something that came about as a result of a man, an editor, deciding that maybe if he recorded the words of Jesus in red, then they would stick out to people, and people then would understand. Prior to that, most of the time, the only way you would know it was the words of the Lord was if there were quotation marks that were added to it. And so, and his inspiration, as I told you, came from Luke chapter 22 and verse 20. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. And so in 1889, Louis Klopsich, editor of the Christian Herald magazine, thought of this idea. He ran it past one of his mentors, and his mentor said, I cannot see how this would harm anything. In fact, I think it would be very beneficial. And so thus was born in 1889 the first red letter Bible, the first red letter New Testament. And in 1901, the first red letter Bible was printed. And from that day till this, it's a very popular Bible. I have one in front of me. A red letter Bible is not necessarily any more spiritual than a not red letter Bible. It just makes it easier for one to recognize the words of Jesus. Now, I went from that point to a long explanation to you that all of the words in the Bible are the words of the Lord. And so it's not that we should discount any of the words that are written in the Scripture. And I gave you several internal evidences using the Word of God itself to prove to you that every word is the Word of God. It's what we call plenary verbal inspiration, meaning that every word is inspired, as opposed to what some people believe, that just the thoughts and the ideas or the concepts are inspired. We have to believe that every word of Scripture is inspired of God. Amen. The word inspired comes from two words, from the word theonoustos, which comes from two Greek words, which means God breathed. Theo meaning God, noustos meaning breath. And so all Scripture is given, the writer said, by inspiration of God. God breathed it. And so it's not that we can, that we want to, there are some people who say, well, I don't believe anything in the Bible except the red letters. And that is a false premise to live by as well. And so the red words are very important because those, of course, are the direct quotes of the Lord. But every word is important because it is the Word of God. So I gave you several internal evidences, proofs from Scripture to prove that the Scripture is the Word of God. And that would be a bit of circular reasoning to some. Not to me, but to some. They would say, well, you're using the Bible to prove the Bible is true. So that's not valid. So then I gave you several external evidences to prove that the Word of God is, the Bible is the Word of God. So I won't go back and tell you all of those. Normally I would have, but I'm not going to go back and tell you all of those in brief because that would take too long. And I'm down to about 30 seconds, I think, for my review. So then I shared with you that there are nine different occasions in the book of Acts where the words of Jesus are quoted by the writer Luke. We know that Luke was the author of the book of Acts, and Luke, of course, was there with the Lord, and he heard these words, and so when these words are quoted, whether it be through his own words in the first chapter, or whether it be through a voice from heaven claiming, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest, we have the words of the Lord of Jesus in red letters. So we began in Acts chapter 1, verses 4 and 5, and verses 7 and 8, and these were the words, Jesus' words to the disciples after his resurrection. We talked all about those words. Secondly, we talked about the words of Jesus to Saul of Tarsus on the road to Damascus, which are recorded in Acts chapter 9, and then again in Acts chapter 22. I won't reteach those when we get to chapter 22, but both of these instances are the same experience, the words of Jesus, and which now brings us, and how long was that? Not very long. Now it brings us to our third time, which is where we will begin tonight. The third time where the words of Jesus are recorded in the book of Acts. And it actually is in Acts chapter 9 as well. And if you want to turn there with me, Acts chapter 9 and verses 11 through 16. Acts chapter 9, verses 11 through 16. And these are the words of the Lord spoken to Ananias. Ananias was the one who brought Saul of Tarsus, as you may well know, to the knowledge of the truth. He was there to baptize him and there for him to receive the Holy Ghost. And so this was a really difficult moment. This took some significant some significant endeavor of the Lord to get this to come to pass. Because here you have Saul of Tarsus, a very educated man, a man who is very sincere, thinking he's doing exactly the right thing. And he is killing these Christians, and he is dragging them to prison, and he is doing everything he can to stop this, what he thought to be a heresy, this new issue, if you please, of the new birth. And so he has been persecuting the Christians in Jerusalem. He was there when they stoned Stephen, the first martyr of the church. And now his vision is growing, and he's getting more and more ambitious in his actions. And so now he seeks letters from the high priest. You have to understand that. This was a spiritual thing. This was a religious thing. This was the high priest. This is the Jewish religious hierarchy. And they're trying to put a stop to this thing called Christianity because they don't understand it and they don't recognize it. And they think that it's an affront against the law of Moses. And so they're trying to stop this. And so Saul, in his ambition, says, I have heard that they have escaped to Damascus. And so if you'll give me letters giving me authority, I will go to Damascus and I will do my best to stamp out this new doctrine that is going forth in Damascus as well. And so on the road to Damascus, as we mentioned last week, that is when the Lord arrested him on his journey and spoke to him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? Who art thou, Lord? He said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. So you know that Saul of Tarsus did not have the best of reputations from the Christian world, the followers of Christ. And so now the Lord has got to get someone to baptize him, someone to enlighten him, someone to help him come to the knowledge of the truth. And so the Lord speaks to a man by the name of Ananias, who lived in Damascus. Now the Lord had already been working. That's interesting. The Lord had already told Saul, you go to a certain place. At the same time, now the Lord is working on this man Ananias to tell him to go to this same place. Now can I pause here and tell you that when you're doing the work of the Lord, don't you ever think that you are doing it alone. When you are doing what God has called you to do, He is working at the same time you're working. Amen. If He inspires you to go talk to somebody, there's a good chance that He has already been talking to them.
Yes, sir.
You don't have to be worried. You don't have to be upset. God works on both sides of the issue. Amen. And I know sometimes we worry, well, what if they don't listen? Well, what if they think I'm weird? Or what if whatever? And we have all of these scenarios in our mind. This is an example to us that God was not only talking to a sinner, He was talking to the saint to talk to the sinner. Amen. And so it behooves us as Christians, as children of God, to be sensitive to the Spirit. I mean, when you come into a church service, be sensitive to the Spirit. Because the Lord may be wanting to talk to you to tell you to go lay your hand on that person to pray for them, because they might have just prayed, Lord, if this is really the real thing, then somebody needs to come over and lay their hand on me right now.
Amen.
And so I'm not asking us to just, you know, to do things, I don't even know what this means, but, you know, willy-nilly. I'm not just asking us just to do things just because we got this wild idea. But if God is speaking to us, then we need to be sensitive to His Spirit. If you walk past someone and God says, invite them to the friend day, there's a good possibility they've been saying, Lord, I'm hungry for more. I want something more in my spiritual life. And when you invite them, it may very well be something will click in their spirit. And so that's exactly what was happening in Acts chapter 9. And so the Lord speaks to him. It's very interesting in verse number 11. And the Lord said, verse 10, there was a certain disciple. I think that's one of the things we need to stop here and think about. Ananias was a disciple. What is a disciple? A disciple is a learner. It is someone who is learning. It's someone who is understanding more and more from the teacher. A disciple is a learner, so please don't ever think that you have learned everything. I don't want to ever get to the place where I think I can't learn anything else. Because when I'm a learner, then God can speak to me. When my heart is open, when my mind is open, God can speak to me. Amen. You have to have, and I have to have a teachable spirit. Could I just teach for a moment here? We need teachable spirits. We need to be willing for God to tell us maybe we're wrong, if we're wrong. We need to be willing to have our theology corrected by the Word of God. We need to listen to somebody who may know a little bit more than we know. And so he was a disciple. And the way that he... Think about this. Almost the whole then known world was affected by this man, Saul of Tarsus, who became the Apostle Paul, who started churches all over Asia Minor and even into Europe. And it all happened because one man had a very teachable spirit, and he was a disciple. You never know who that convert that you're going to reach is going to reach. You never know who that person you're going to bring to the Lord is going to bring to the Lord. Amen. And so we need to have our hearts open, our minds open. We need to be disciples, followers, learners of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. I want to have a teachable spirit. I want to have a spirit that's open that God can use me. Amen. Verse 11. You'll notice what he says. He told him in a vision, Ananias, and he said, "Behold, I am here." And the Lord said unto him, "Arise and go into the street which is called Straight." Now think about this. You are probably never going to do what God's called you to do staying right where you are. We are never going to accomplish what God is calling us to do if we don't get up and go. If we don't begin to move. You're never going to invite someone to Friend Day unless you move out of the mode that you have been in for a long time. If you don't take any announcements, you're not going to pass any out. All right? Was that too deep for you? The truth is we're going to have to get up and do some moving. We're going to have to make some changes if we're going to accomplish what God has called us to accomplish. And so to do the work of the Lord, we're going to need to get up from where we are and move to the place that the Lord directs us. And the truth is, we all like to stay where we are. We all like to stay in that comfortable place where we are. Amen. But we're going to have to get up and move and follow the direction of the Lord. Amen. And so it's not possible to always stay right where we are and do all the things that we've just always done and still find that Saul of Tarsus that is going to be the man that helps change the whole world. Amen. And so the first thing the Lord says to Ananias is he calls him by name. I want to hear the Lord when he speaks my name. Secondly, he says, get up from where you are and go to the street called Straight and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus, for behold, he prayeth. Now you think about that with me for a minute. He's praying. The Lord said to Ananias, get up away from where you are, move to another place, to another dimension, if you please, because somebody is praying. Behold, he prayeth. The first thing I would remind us is that God pays attention when you pray. God pays attention when people pray. Amen. You say, well, I've been praying a long time and I've not seen the answer yet. Don't you ever forget, your prayers are important and God pays attention. He knew when Saul was praying. He knows when you are praying. He hears every prayer that we pray. And I know Brother Jokey says it often, but it's the truth. Prayers are never in vain. Amen. They are never unimportant. They are so important that the Lord collects our prayers. And one of these days, He's going to pour them out on the earth. And so our prayers are very important. And I want you to think about this as well. The people that you're trying to reach, their prayers are important as well. Saul of Tarsus was a bad guy. He was so wrong. He was so bad. In fact, Ananias is all upset about this whole assignment that he's received. He said, this guy, I've heard a lot of bad things about this guy. I've heard a lot of bad things about this guy, and you want me to go preach to him? And the Lord said, he's been praying. And when he's praying, you need to go, because everything changes when we pray. Amen. Notice, when Saul prayed, he saw a vision of his future. When Saul prayed, he saw a vision of his future. Behold, he prayeth, and hath seen in a vision, verse 12, a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hands on him, that he might receive his sight. Does it seem strange to you that we have visions when we pray? Does it seem? I think that's a pretty normal scenario, because when we're praying, we're tapping into the supernatural. When we're praying, we're tapping into something beyond humanity. And when we begin to pray, God begins to build faith in our hearts, and we begin to see the impossible. We begin to see things that are not as though they are, because we're praying. Now, if you're not praying, then you just, all you have is what you can do, and all you have is your own ability and your own strength. Then I don't expect you to have very many visions, because we're all so inept. We are all so unable. We are all so small in our abilities. But when we pray, we are connecting with eternity. We are joining hands with the Almighty God, who can do anything, who can change people's minds, who can change people's lives. And so I'm telling you, we need to really pray, because when we pray, we see visions, and when we see visions, we see miracles. Praise God. And so the words of Jesus to Ananias are so powerful, because he's telling Ananias, Saul is praying, and as he's praying, he has seen visions of his future. Praise God. I've had people tell me this before. I was praying, and the Lord showed me myself standing preaching to a group of people. And I say to them, you need to follow that, and you need to continue to walk towards that, because God speaks to us when we pray. He gives us visions when we pray. And years later, it happened. Years and years later, they found the fulfillment of that vision that they had, and they woke up and realized that was it. It happened, but it happened as they prayed. Amen. And so, behold, he prayeth. When Saul prayed, he saw a vision of his future. If you want an answer from God, my suggestion to you is pray like you've never prayed before, because God speaks to us when we pray. Amen. God speaks to us when we pray. Ananias, of course, was a bit skittish about this whole proposal, but the words of the Lord came to assure him. He knew about Saul of Tarsus. He knew what he had done in Jerusalem. He knew how he had destroyed the Christians. And Ananias said, verse 13, Lord, I have heard of many of this man how much evil he hath done to thy saints at Jerusalem. I mean, that's a pretty strong word he's using there, evil. He didn't just say he's made a few mistakes. He said he is evil. He's done evil. He's done very bad things. And here he hath authority from the chief priest to bind all that call on thy name. I mean, Saul of Tarsus' reputation had gone before him. Ananias already knew he was there, and knew that he had authority, and knew that he was there to arrest and to even destroy the people that were calling on the name of the Lord. But I want you to notice what the Lord said to him, and this is so powerful. Notice verse number 15. He said, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel. Now you think about that. Think about those words. He is a chosen vessel. I mean, this guy is killing Christians. This guy is doing the exact opposite of what Ananias is trying to do. And yet the Lord says he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. He's a chosen vessel. And so I'm guessing that we should never discount anybody that we're witnessing to. I'm guessing that we should never marginalize anybody that God is directing us to talk to. Because I might say, you know, that person is way out there. That person is way beyond help. That person is way beyond usefulness in the kingdom of God. And the Lord may be speaking back and saying, they are a chosen vessel. In fact, the truth of the matter is if he was looking for someone that we all would have said, you know, most likely to spiritually succeed, I doubt that very many of us would have been on that list. I doubt that very many of us in our previous life before we came to know the Lord would have ever been most likely to spiritually succeed. But the Lord looks at us and he sees deeper than our actions. He sees deeper than where we are right now. He sees a heart that might be somehow saying, you know, I don't like this. I don't like living like this, but I just don't know any way out. I'm just doing what I know to do, and what I know to do doesn't seem to be working. And all along, the Lord is speaking and the Lord is working in people's lives. And he, if we'll hear his voice, he'll be saying something like this: don't discount them. They are a chosen vessel. I've got plans for them. They're going to be used of me. That may be the next Sunday school teacher at the Dewar United Pentecostal Church. They may be the next choir member at the church. They may be the next people that are going to be leading worship at the church. Don't ever discount anybody. Listen to the voice of God. Amen. He is a chosen vessel. He is a chosen vessel unto me. Aren't you thankful that the Lord can give us assurance? Ananias needed that assurance. And sometimes the plans of God are so beyond me. And sometimes the plans of God are so opposite of what I think. But I'm so glad that he can come with his word and assure me it's going to be okay. You just do what I tell you. Because I have plans, and I'm working this out. There's a missing piece of this puzzle that you don't see right now. But when I put it in place, everything's going to make sense to you. Don't give up. Don't quit. Trust me. Amen. He is a chosen vessel unto me. Amen. Amen. So I'm challenging us, don't quit on anybody. Don't ignore anybody. Amen. There's some people that I've passed by and I thought to myself, they would be the last people in the world that I would think would come to the church and receive the Holy Ghost. And I can name some of you. I won't say it because I'll offend you and you'll be mad at me. But in my flesh, I didn't have a lot of high hopes for some of the people that are now Sunday school teachers, worship leaders, musicians, choir members in this church. Because I can see, and if I look at it just from my own understanding, I could discount. But the Lord spoke to Ananias and said, don't do that. He is a chosen vessel, and he's going to do more than you can imagine. Amen. And I thank God. I thank God that he sees beyond our present situation, and he can change our lives for eternity. I'm struck by the results of the word of the Lord to Ananias, verses 17 and 18. And Ananias went his way and entered into the house and put his hands on him, said, Brother Saul. I wonder how much faith that took. I wonder how much courage that took. Brother Saul. Brother Saul. That's before you ever got the Holy Ghost. Interesting. I've had people say, well, you can't call them brother till they get the Holy Ghost. I don't ever want people to feel like they're okay where they are till they receive the Holy Ghost. But you know what? If I call them brother and that helps them, then okay, I'm going to keep reaching for them until they get the Holy Ghost. He called him Brother Saul. Brother Saul, the Lord even Jesus, I love that. The Lord even Jesus, there's that word chi, even, translated as even instead of and. The Lord even Jesus that appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest hath sent me, that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And immediately there fell from his eyes as it had been scales, and he received sight forthwith and arose and was baptized. You see, when the words of the Lord come to you, it changes everything. It changes everything. I'm so thankful for the assurance of the word of the Lord. Amen. Obedience to the word of the Lord is so powerful. If God is talking to you to do something, I'm going to tell you in the fear of God, do it. Because when you do it, powerful things happen. Powerful things happen. Amen. Amen. Have you ever missed an opportunity and you knew you missed it? I'm telling you, I don't like that feeling. And I want to do what God's telling me to do, because when I hear the voice of God and I do what he's told me to do, something amazing can result from that. Think about it. The man who became the writer of the majority of the books of the New Testament, the greatest missionary that ever walked on the face of the earth, was converted because one Ananias said, okay, I don't understand this, but you're telling me what to do, and I'm going to go do it. Amen. I was talking to somebody the other day, maybe it was Brother Jokey, maybe he told me this. Someone said, who is the greatest soul winner in the Bible, or something to this effect? And they said, well, I guess it would be the Apostle Paul. And then someone said, well, what about Ananias? Because without Ananias, there would have been no Saul. So I'm telling you, as God speaks to us, we can be involved in something extremely powerful, amen, when we obey the commandments of the Lord. Amen. Okay, so that's the words of the Lord to Ananias. Now we're going to skip to the 11th chapter, chapter 11, and verse number 16. And these are the words, Peter recalling the words of Jesus. Just prior to Jesus' ascension, he's recalling the words of Jesus. The theme of the 10th chapter of Acts was that the gospel was coming to the Gentiles. Now in chapter 11, we see the first Gentile church established. And the news that the Gentiles had received the Holy Spirit, just as the Jews had and the Samaritans had, it reached Jerusalem, the church in Jerusalem, before Peter got there. It was clear that Christianity was not going to be merely another sect of religious people or another branch of Judaism. It became clear to the early church that the gospel of Jesus Christ was going to be preached throughout the whole world, and that it was much different than the law. Well, the early church, you understand, they've been following this law for thousands of years. Now they receive the Holy Ghost. And they were not against the Holy Ghost, but they were thinking that in order to receive the Holy Spirit, you had to become a Jew first. And then you could come through Judaism into the kingdom of God. Well, now when the Gentiles received the Holy Spirit, this kind of blew their theory. And they began to realize this was their first thought. This is not right. We believe in the Holy Ghost, and we believe in baptism in Jesus' name, but we believe you have to be a Jew first, and you have to come through Judaism, and that's the path you take into the kingdom of God. Well, when the Gentiles received the Holy Ghost, they didn't come that way. And so now the religious leaders of the early church are all messed up. Their minds are all frazzled. They don't understand. So now they're getting ready to really rake Simon Peter over the coals, because of what he has done. And so while Peter remained in Caesarea, word of the remarkable event of the Gentiles receiving the Holy Ghost reached Jerusalem. And so when he finally arrived in Jerusalem, the Jews contended with him over this issue. Look at chapter 11, verse number 2. And when Peter was come up to Jerusalem, they that were of the circumcision, meaning the Jewish people, contended with him, saying, thou wentest into men uncircumcised and didst eat with them. And so they're now giving him all sorts of trouble because he was now preaching to Gentiles that had not followed the laws of Judaism. And they're thinking that, you know, he's wrong and we're going to have to set him straight. And so even though they were believers, they were not yet on the same page with the Lord. They were still contending for their Jewish customs. And I want you to notice what Peter did not do. He did not argue with them. Instead of facing their prejudices head on, he chose a different path. He merely began to rehearse the matter to them, how it all happened from the very, very beginning, how the Gentiles had received the Holy Ghost. I won't take time to read verses 5 through 17, but if we were to read verses 5 through 17, you would find that he is rehearsing the event of what took place in chapter 10, how the Gentiles in Cornelius' house had received the Holy Ghost. If you will notice in verse number 12, he said, the Spirit bade me go with them, nothing doubting. Moreover, these six brethren accompanied me, and we entered into the man's house. So one of the first things he told them is he said, I had six witnesses that this happened. This is not just me. There are six witnesses. Now, this was important to the Jewish people because according to the law, at least two or three witnesses, let every word be established. So he was kind of using their law to kind of convince them that he has the witnesses to prove this. Notice verse 14. He said, I was told, who shall tell thee words whereby thou and all thy house shall be saved? So he is now equating what took place at Cornelius' house that he saw in that vision in Caesarea. This was for salvation. So he said, you know, how can I stop this from happening? This was for salvation. And then the last thing he did that really cemented his argument is he said this, verse number 16, he said, then remembered I the word of the Lord, how that he said, and now he's quoting Acts chapter 1, verse number 5, I remember the words of Jesus, John indeed baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. And when he reminded them of that, and he told them that, and how this whole scenario had taken place, and he reached back to the original words of Jesus that were spoken to him, I want you to see what happened. Verse 17. For as much then, this is their response, for as much then as God gave them the light gift, as he did unto us who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, what was I, he said, that I could withstand God? And when they heard these words, they held their peace and glorified God, saying, then hath God also to the Gentiles granted repentance unto life. Amen. So here's what Peter did. He remembered back. He hearkened back to the words of Jesus. Not only the words that were spoken directly to him that he quoted, but he also remembered in verse 17 those words about that the Lord had spoken. And when he gave them these words, it changed everything. Amen. And so what is my point for this? What is the application of these verses? I think we need to go right back to the words of Jesus. If we're going to do the will of God, then we have to go back and use as our resource the words of the Lord himself. We can't just make something up. We've got to go back to the word of God. And that's exactly what Peter did. He remembered the words of the Lord, which said, you will be John baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Amen. The way that we keep on track back as we try and have revival and as we try to move toward the coming of the Lord is we go by the words of the Lord. We don't get some new doctrine that we cannot prove from the Scripture. We do not just kind of make something up and kind of twist a verse to make it happen. We do just exactly like Simon Peter did, and that is, he said, everything I'm doing, I'm tying back to the very words of Jesus himself. He said, I will baptize you with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Amen. I'm thankful for the confirmation of the Word of God. I'm thankful for the Word of God that can teach me and train me and lead me and guide me. I'm also thankful that I can come to the house of God and hear preaching and teaching, and it can confirm to me something that God's been dealing with me about. Here's a novel idea. This is why we come to church. It's because when you hear the word preached, when you hear the word of God go forth, it will be the very thing that will cement what God has already been talking to you about. It will confirm. The Scripture says He will confirm His word. Amen. He confirms His word. Amen. And so, I'm saying coming to church faithfully is very important. You can't just come every now and then, unless, of course, you don't need any direction or you don't need anything. But I don't think that's true. I think we all need to hear the voice of God to guide us and direct us. And it's beautiful to me how God can take one sermon. God can even take one statement. And that one statement, He can answer your question and your question and your question and your question, all with the one statement. Amen. I've had people come up to me after church before. And I've had them call me before church and say, I've got a question I need to ask you before church, after church tonight. I said, okay, that's fine. After church, they'd walk up and say, I don't need to, you answer the question in the Bible study. I don't need to ask you the question. Amen. And I've had people come up to me and say, you know, when you said such and such and such and such, that really helped me because that's what I was wondering about. And I don't even remember saying such and such and such and such. And there's a good possibility I didn't even say it. It's a good possibility you just heard it. You just heard something. Brother Tenney said he was talking to a man one time, and the man said, you said so-and-so. He said, I don't know what you heard, but I know what I said, and I didn't say that. Sometimes God can take a few words, and it can explode in our mind, and He can answer our question when the answer we got from that wouldn't even... Someone else would never get that answer out of it. That's why preaching is so important. God hath chosen by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. Amen. And so the Word of God is very important. The words of Jesus will keep us on track just like it did Peter. Amen. That was kind of new territory for them, you understand. And the way he navigated that new territory was by the words of Jesus. Amen. And God will never take us somewhere that His Word won't inspire and guide us. Amen. So I'm thankful for that. Amen. All right. I've got to get to two more, and then I'll be done for the night. Chapter 18, verses 9 and 10. Chapter 18, verses 9 and 10. Now, I'm going to give you just some background into this setting so you'll understand the significance of the words of Jesus that are quoted in Acts chapter 18. Chapter 18 is divided into two parts. The first part of the chapter shares with us how Paul found comfort and strength in a personally very difficult time in his life. He found himself in the city of Corinth. And from his own testimony, it was a difficult time for him personally. He was discouraged. I know some of you think that, you know, people should never be discouraged. But, you know, if you can figure that out, let me know. I don't think we should live there. And I think we should work our way through that. But sometimes, you know, sometimes life is difficult. And sometimes there are challenges. And sometimes we're not as high up on the mountain as we are at other times. And so, of course, there's no doubt that there was a combination of events that happened in Paul's life that placed him in this unfamiliar place of discouragement. Among the contributors of his discouragement might have been, number one, he had very limited success in Athens right before he came to Corinth. And so you know, he might have felt a little like, I don't know if I'm doing everything I can do. I don't know if I'm allowing God to use me in all the ways that he wants to use me. So he might have felt a little discouraged from his limited success in Athens. He was by himself. He was lonely. And I know that that sometimes loneliness is the real deal. You can be surrounded by hundreds of people and be very lonely. And he was surrounded by a whole city full of people, but he felt alone. He felt by himself. He felt the challenges of a very sinful and a very wicked city of Corinth. To understand the city of Corinth of that day, you would have to understand that Corinth had replaced Athens as the leading political and commercial center of Greece. The city enjoyed a very strategic location. It was located on the Isthmus of Corinth, which connected north and south Greece. In order to go around the southern tip of Greece, it was 200 miles by ship. Therefore, many ships were put on rollers and pulled across the four-mile land bridge right there at Corinth. Emperor Nero started a canal in 67 AD to try and connect the from one side of Greece to the other across that four-mile peninsula, but he never finished the project. It was finally completed in the year 1893, but before it was completed, they would place ships on rollers and pull them across that land bridge so they wouldn't have to go 200 miles around the southern tip of Greece. Greece was a trade center. Corinth was a trade center of Greece. It was a very unsettled place. Much of the population was mobile and consisted of sailors and businessmen and government agents. As a result, Corinth was one of the most wicked and ungodly cities of antiquity. In fact, the very term Corinthian came to mean immoral or corrupt. To Corinthianize meant to practice whoredoms or immorality. Towering some 1,500 feet above Corinth was the Acropolis, on which sat the temple of the goddess Aphrodite, the goddess of love. Every evening, 1,000 priestesses, which were nothing more than temple prostitutes, would descend into the city of Corinth. And so you can understand, as you read through the book of 1 and 2 Corinthians, the issues that Paul was dealing with was a result of what was happening in that city. It was a very wicked, a very ungodly city. Now maybe we can understand why he felt a little bit of discouragement. The lack of success in Athens, his loneliness, the very wicked city that he was trying to reach with the gospel. He had feelings of weakness and fear, according to his own testimony. It is possible that he was even suffering from some lingering physical issues resulting from the beatings that he received in Philippi. Paul's own writings confirm that he was having trouble. He was discouraged. 1 Corinthians 2 and 3, he said, I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 7, which is written from Corinth, he said, for this reason, brethren, in all our distress and affliction, we are comforted about you through your faith. 2 Corinthians 1, 3, he refers to the God of all comfort. Sounds to me like he was understanding. He was in a rough place. He was in a difficult place. 2 Corinthians 7 and 6, the God who comforts the depressed. And so you understand that he was in a very difficult place, a place of discouragement, a place of frustration, a place where he needed something. Have you ever been there? You just wanted the phone to ring? You just wanted there to be a card in the mail? You just wanted somebody to say, I've been praying for you? You wanted somebody to say, God gave me a dream and told me that it was going to be all right. This is what I saw. Amen. He was at that place in his life. And when he was at that place in his life, the scripture says, then verses 9 and 10, then spake the Lord to Paul in the night by a vision, be not afraid, but speak, and hold not thy peace, for I am with thee, and no man shall sit on thee to hurt thee, for I have much people in this city. And I'm telling you one thing, that must have been the greatest morning when he woke up, after the words of Jesus came to him in that dream. And I'm telling you, you think about those words, because those words will be absolute comfort to you as well. Be not afraid. Be not afraid. It doesn't matter what you're facing. The Lord said, be not afraid. It doesn't matter how much the devil gets in your ear and tries to discourage you and frustrate you. Don't be afraid. What wonderful words those are. What great words those are to him and to us. I am with thee. What more do you want? If God is with us, then who can be against us? Amen. He promised he'd never leave us. He would never forsake us. He would be with us even to the end of the age, no matter how far you go. Don't be discouraged, because the Lord said, I am with you. No man is going to harm thee. Kind of strange language for us. No man's going to sit on you to harm you. I remember studying the book of Acts, thinking about trying to memorize that verse, thinking about somebody sitting on top of me. It's not really what he meant, but he meant nobody's going to descend on you and harm you. Nobody's going to get to where you are and destroy you. I am with you, and I am going to take care of you. Maybe every now and then we need to tell the Lord, you know what? Jesus told me that nobody's going to harm me, and nobody's going to destroy me, so you might as well take off, because I'm going to be okay. Amen. Amen. Be not afraid. I am with thee. No man shall harm thee. And number four, I have much people in this city. Keep preaching. Keep witnessing. Keep inviting. Keep living this life in front of those people around you, because I have much people in this city. Amen. I just came to tell somebody, you know, you get a little discouraged every now and then. That doesn't mean you're backslidden. It just means life sometimes kind of piles on. But when life piles on, get your nose in the book and get a vision from the Lord and hear his word. Don't be afraid. I am with you. Nobody's going to harm you. And we're going to have revival. Amen. What wonderful words those are in times of discouragement. Amen. Amen. We can't afford to live in whatever they call depression. You know? Can't afford to live there. We've got a lot to be thankful for. Count your blessings, name them one by one, and you'll begin to realize how much the Lord has done. So we do have a lot to be thankful for. And so I rebuke and I speak against a spirit of depression that tries to come on us. Amen. Amen. It does not belong on you. It does not belong on a child of God. Amen. Have your pity party and get over it. Amen. Stick your bottom lip out and pout for a day or so, and then get over it and get better. Because it's going to be okay. Because greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Jesus has got you on his mind. Amen. Amen. He's got much people in this city. He is with you. Don't be afraid. No man's going to hurt you. Amen. Which brings us now to our last words that we're going to do tonight. And these are this is chapter 20, verse 35. This is the unrecorded words of Jesus. The unrecorded words of Jesus. The setting that contains these unrecorded words of Jesus is Paul is challenging the church leaders in Ephesus just before he left to go to Jerusalem. When he arrived in Jerusalem, his missionary journeys would come to an end. So this was, in some respects, his last chance to speak to the leaders, the church leaders, of the church in Ephesus. And so his final words to them, he highlighted five important priorities for them. And if you want to look at verse 28, he said, take heed unto yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers. Feed the flock of God which he hath purchased with his own blood. So the first thing he told them, his last words, parting words to them, is verse 28, is to take heed therefore unto yourselves. Be right with God. Make sure that you keep your spiritual life up to date. Don't lose out on your relationship with God. The second thing he told them is not only take heed unto yourselves, but unto the flock over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers. So he says, you have a responsibility. Take care of the flock. Take care of yourself first. Secondarily, take care of the flock. The third thing he told them, verses 29 through 31, won't take time to read them, but he's saying, guard the flock. As a man of God, as leaders, you have to guard. You have to watch out. Watch and remember that by the space of 3 years, so on and so forth. So watch over them. The fourth thing he said in verse 32, he says, I want you to study and I want you to pray, because as I have done, as I have studied and prayed, it has benefited you, and you have been blessed. And if you will do the same thing that I have done, then you will bless those people that are following you. And then he brings them to the final instruction, which he quotes the unrecorded words of Jesus in this passage. This final instruction of Paul, we find the unrecorded words of Jesus. This is the only passage in the New Testament that is a quote of Jesus and not recorded in the Gospels. It must have been a well-known saying of Jesus as he ministered on the earth. He must have used it enough times that it was common knowledge to anyone who lived during that time. And so in order to make his final point, Paul says to them, he says, I want you to be free from self-interest. I don't want you to be materialistic. I don't want you to be all about money. I don't want you to be all about possessions. I don't want you to be all about what's in it for me. I don't want you to be all about money. I want you to forget about self-interest, and I want you to have the interest of the church at heart. And then he quoted the words of the Lord Jesus, how he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. It is more blessed to give than to receive. So what did Jesus mean by these words? What did he mean by when he said, it's more blessed to give than to receive? I'm sure there were many things that he meant by these words. Maybe it could be stated this way. It's better to be the one giving than the one who needs to be given to. You are more blessed if you are the one that have resources to help somebody else than to be the one who has no resources and needs to be given to. Another way to say that is it's more blessed to be the doctor than the patient. It's more blessed to be giving than to be receiving. And we live in a very materialistic world, don't we? Everything is very materialistic, and it's more about what's in it for me. And really, that is the opposite of the attitude of a Christian. Amen. Paul's ministry was successful because he kept his relationship right with God, because he fed the flock, because he guarded the flock, because he devoted himself to prayer and study, and because he lived his life free of self-interest. In fact, at one point he said, I didn't even take your money. I came and worked so that you didn't have to give me money, because I wanted you to have the gospel. It wasn't about what he could get out of it. It was about what he could give to it. And I'm going to take the last few minutes here, and I want to talk to you about materialism. We live in a very materialistic world, and it can happen to you and I just as much as it can happen to the person on the street. Amen. And God wants to bless us, But he wants to bless us so that we can bless others and bless his kingdom. Amen. And I think that we should be really careful that we don't adopt the attitude of the world, and that is, you know, it's me. I got to keep what I've got. I don't have enough. And the truth is that we'll never think that we have enough. We will never think that we have enough. And if God is ever speaking to you to do something, to give something, then he will make it up to you. I want to read, and I hope you don't take offense to this, but I'm going to read. I read this amazing article out of Christianity Today magazine, and it's the title of the article is "Wait, What Is Money?" And in this, I referenced this back of maybe it was in our World Missions Day, but I just want to read excerpts of this article to you because I think it will help us understand how we really should view money and possessions and things. The author of the article is Susan Metis, and she said, "Paying for groceries may seem routine, but if you stop to think, it may be hard to describe exactly what is happening. We slide a bit of plastic, press a few buttons, we get food in exchange for what exactly? Money? The promise of money? Something that represents something else that represents money? Our payment system is not all that different from that of the Pacific Islanders who paid each other and counted their wealth in giant limestone rings. The rings were too heavy to move, so the community had a great track orally who owned that ring. The major transactions conducted using the stones did not involve a physical exchange. They simply involved a communal agreement about what those giant curved discs could mean. Money is not always coins, paper bills, or even bank records. It has been stones, metal rods, and cows in a field. If in practical terms all of these things are money, all of these things are money, what is money? I prefer, she said, to ask what money does rather than what money is, says Philip Goodchild, professor of religion and philosophy at the University of Nottingham. It functions in a variety of ways, including, quote, the basis by which we give things prices, a medium of exchange, and a standard for future payments. Brad Hewitt, CEO of Thrivent Financial, said, I describe money, this is really what I want you to hear, I describe money as love or service in a storable or transferable form. I describe money as love or service in a storable or transferable form. That's really money's purpose, to demonstrate love or service. And how can either use it to serve ourselves or instead to show love for our family and support our neighbors, community, and world? So he said, really, money should be understood as the ability to give love or service. Because really, what good is money if you don't give it or if you don't use it? You might have hundreds of thousands of dollars in a bank and be the most miserable person in the world. Because really, money is not the thing that ever makes anyone happy. It's what you do with it. And so, I won't take time to read all of this to you, but let me read a little bit more. He said, money is, in a way, the letter in an algebra equation. It's the substitute until the real value of something has been met by something else. And that real value can change dramatically based on what a culture believes. For example, West Africans in the late 1800s used iron rods, which they called kissy pennies, as money. A kissy penny was believed to have spiritual power and became worthless if it broke. Why was it worthless if it broke? Because its users decided it was worthless if it broke. and thus it was truly worthless. And so the value of money is what you say is valuable. It's not that you have a wad of bills in your billfold. It's that what you ascribe value to. Money is essentially a trusted system of exchange agreed upon mutually by society, Hewitt said. But just as each society decides what its money can do, each of us individually can decide what money can do in our lives, Hewitt said. So we have to decide. We have to decide what we do with our money and what value we give it to. In the proprietary research for his book, Money Mindset, Hewitt and his team found that nearly 50% of Christians feel financially insecure, and more than 85% of Christians feel they do not have enough to share generously. But what he found especially noteworthy was the fact that when Christians did with their money, that what Christians did with their money had a far greater effect on their attitude than the amount of money they had. Ratcheting up income doesn't bestow the peace and freedom experienced by those who have decided they have enough to share, even if enough doesn't include trappings of the so-called good life. Enough might not look like much to anyone else, but people with a surplus mindset experience an amazing state of contentment. In other words, if you have this surplus mentality that, you know what, I have enough, and I have more than enough, so therefore I can share what I have with somebody else. Those people have an amazing, according to psychiatrists, an amazing state of contentment. Behavioral economics have revealed reasons to believe that no exchange of goods and money is free from its ability to warp perspectives. Money has a special psychological effect. In experiments, the presence of money, even play money, prompted subjects to act more selfishly and self-sufficiently and less cooperatively and less kindly. People's minds have a special reaction to money as well. When we spend cash, it often lights up the pain centers in our brains. I can understand that. When we recognize the psychological and emotional connections we have with money, we bring awareness to the role it plays in our lives. The biblical truth is that it's better to give than to receive. When we internalize that truth, our unhealthy perceptions about money start to dissolve. Embracing a new money mindset, like any renewing of your mind, isn't easy, he said, but it starts simply. Be generous. Give before you think you have enough to give. This applies not only to money, but also to time, to talents, as a currency of love and service. His advice differs significantly from prosperity gospel preachers. This isn't a gimmick. When you give, you won't suddenly have more money. But as your mindset shifts, you will gain a clearer sense of your priorities in managing what you already have. And so in reality, you will have more, because all of the things that were so important before are not important and that important anymore. In other words, money may be the X in an algebra equation, but multiplying the letter doesn't necessarily change our values. Money is always a substitute for a value and a mindset that already exists somewhere else. In healthy interpersonal relationship, you want a strong emotional connection, but the opposite is true in regards to a relationship with money. When we remove our emotional attachment and instead look at money merely as a tool, we can then right-size money's role in our lives and begin to make wise financial decisions and live generous lives. I guess I would sum all that up to say is that I want to be more generous. I really do. I want to be more generous. And I say, well, you know, I'm not going to get Social Security when I retire because I had the opportunity to exempt Social Security when I came out of Bible college. So I'm not going to get Social Security when I retire. So there's something in the back of my mind that says, you better hang on. You better hold on to everything you've got. But I ask myself the question many times, when is enough enough? What's enough? You know, at what point do I say, you know what, if God speaks to me, I'm going to do what he tells me to do. Because he's going to take care of me. He always has. And he always will. And so I guess I'm asking us to understand the words of Jesus in Acts. It's more blessed to give than to receive. And I don't want to be the kind of a person that is tight. I want to be this kind of person that anything I've got is available to the Lord if he wants it. And he can take anything he wants. But he'll put back in everything he needs to put in there. And there's one passage that says something like this, I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging bread, and God will take care of us. Amen. Can I get a witness in the house? He's taking good care of you. Yeah. Amen. And so I'm hoping that maybe as we think about the words of Jesus, it's more blessed to give than to receive. And I want to make sure that I do everything he asked me to do. I'm not saying you should go empty your bank accounts, because I'm not planning to do that. But I am saying that if God speaks to me tomorrow and says, you know what, you can give $25 more to missions than you gave last year, I got to be willing to do that. Because he's going to take care of it. He's going to make it up. Somebody's already testified, told me, since they made their pledge to missions, God's already given it back to them several times. I can't remember the exact number, but several times. So all God's looking for is somebody that has the right attitude about money, that we don't let mammon control our lives, but we control that. Amen. And it's more blessed to give than to receive. Amen. And I want to give. I want to give. I'm going to give my time. I want to give my energy. I want to give my finances. I want to give my efforts. I want to give everything he asked me to give. So we're going to finish next week with the Lord's help. We've got a few more, maybe three or four more read words in Acts, and learn words of Jesus in the book of Acts. Amen. I hope you learned something tonight. Let's stand together. Amen. Here I am. Here I stand. Lord, my life is in your hand. Lord, I'm longing to see your desires revealed in me. I give myself away. So you can use me. I give myself away. Oh, I give myself away. So you can use me. Here I am. Here I stand. Lord, my life is in your hands. Lord, I'm longing to see your desires revealed in me. I give myself away. I give myself away. Oh, I give myself away. So you can use me. I'm going to pray a final prayer over this church. I want you to bow your heads with me just feel like I need to do this. Lord Jesus, I pray for this church. I pray for myself as well. I pray that you would help us.